Hello and welcome to the agenda. I am Ajay Kaul. In this program today, we will analyze India's decision to abstain from voting on UNHRC resolution regarding war crimes allegedly committed by Sri Lankan army against ethnic Tamils. India has indirectly supported the Sri Lankan government at the UNHRC by abstaining from voting on a resolution regarding war crimes allegedly committed against ethnic Tamils during the military campaign against LTTE over a decade back. This has angered the political parties in Tamil Nadu, especially at a time when the state is going to have assembly polls. In this episode of the agenda, we will try to analyze and understand the issue and its importance. We have with us retired diplomat Sudhir Deore and geopolitical expert Jitendra Kumar Ojha. But before we start our conversation, have a look at this small report.
The UN Human Rights Commission has adopted a resolution titled Promotion of Reconciliation, Accountability and Human Rights in Sri Lanka after 22nd out of 47 member countries voted in favor of it. India, however, abstained from voting, in effect siding with Sri Lanka on an issue which has been tricky for New Delhi. India had to tread a cautious path of choosing between maintaining friendly relations with Sri Lanka and catering to the sentiments of Tamilians. The issue relates to the alleged war crimes committed by the Sri Lankan forces against ethnic Tamils during the military campaign against the erstwhile LTTE. The civil war ended in 2009 with the elimination of LTTE, which fought for liberation of Tamil-dominated areas of Jaffna from Sri Lanka. The resolution was taken up after a report by the Office of the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights released on January 27, which warned that Sri Lanka's failure to address human rights violations and war crimes committed in the past had put the country on an alarming path that could lead to a reoccurrence of policies and practices of earlier crimes. Shortly before the voting, the India Commission in Geneva released a statement expressing support for Sri Lankan Tamils for equality. It also stressed on unity and territorial integrity of the country. India urged Sri Lanka to carry forward the process of reconciliation and to address the aspirations of the Tamil community and continue to engage constructively with the international community to ensure that the fundamental freedoms and human rights of all its citizens are fully protected. At the same time, it said the work of UNCHR should be in conformity with the mandate given by the relevant resolutions of the UN General Assembly. The abstention has, however, angered some political parties of Tamil Nadu like DMK. This assumes more significance because the state is going to have assembly polls in the coming days. Bureau Report.
Now let's welcome our guests, Ambassador Deore and Mr. Ojha. Welcome to the program, both of you, sir. So I'll first go to Ambassador Deore about India's decision to abstain from voting at the UNHRC on a resolution against Sri Lanka. So how do you see this development?
Well, this is a very delicate and tricky topic in that sense. As you rightly mentioned, it is coming time and we are having, domestic developments. But this is a which was brought up by human rights in Geneva. And this is not the first time. It was brought up 2011, 2012, 2014.
Right.
And in one year, continued also. The resolution expectedly was brought up by Western countries, maybe, and there were a few as well. Yesterday's result showed that out of 47 countries, 22 supported it, 14 countries abstained, including India, and 11 countries rejected it, opposed it. So voting was such a way that it showed the strategic compulsions of some countries, their relation to long-term interests and same time the persistent with the Western countries go up on this issue even after now more decades since the civil war in Sri Lanka ended. As far as India is concerned,
right,
India had in the past couple of time gone along with the resolution, but in 2014 it happened. And if you look at the text of the resolution, which I saw very carefully, I find that there are several passages, several paragraphs,
yeah,
which are highly objective, and they certainly will lead to a constructive approach to dealing with this issue.
What are the objectionable parts?
The objection part in para 5 and 6, the resolution continues to labor on the issue of accountability. On one hand, in the earlier say that the Sri Lankan government is taking steps in that direction, but on the accountability, accountability is very poor. It needs to be further reinforced. With this kind of accountability, you cannot have any system. Whereas 7, it goes further to say that there is a deceleration of human rights situation in Sri Lanka, and in every respect, it is governance, judiciary, the present trend in Sri Lanka, that things are going from to,
yeah,
as far as human rights situation is concerned. You cannot have a kind of a person naming a country and then expect that country to also take steps. So this is the kind of background on which India had to. And I think India's vote, I think, is very balanced, and I think it's the correct approach that India has taken.
Yeah, because it's a tricky situation, as you mentioned. I'll go to Mr. Oja about it. As you heard Ambassador saying that it's a tricky issue for India, because on the one side we had to have good relations with Sri Lanka, at the same time we had to think about the ethnic Tamils sentiment. So what do you say on this? So,
no, I've always said that the kind of neighborhood we are having, no other country in the world has. As far as our linguistic, cultural and civilizational ties are concerned, these are very
strong, both with Tamils as well as Sinhala. Our policies in the past were somewhat, I would say, very inward-looking. We did not engage all the communities. If there something goes wrong in Sri Lanka, it will directly impact our security. So it's very important for us to enjoy goodwill of all sections of people in Sri Lanka. It's not that we should abdicate our responsibility. I feel I had tweeted a couple of days before that India should abstain from voting, and at the same time we should continue our bilateral engagements. Human rights situation is a reality, but sometimes when you openly say something in a collusion with, you know, extra regional powers, it can spoil things for us. It makes us very difficult to engage Sri Lanka bilaterally. Right now, situation is very different. We should take Western confidence and should tell them that they should feel assured this region is our backyard. We are managing. We will look after this situation. That is one way I would say. Secondly, I would say that this thing by, you know, India abstaining is not necessarily, you can say, endorsing Sri Lanka entirely. We have just avoided being in an uncomfortable situation that would impact our bilateral engagement with Sri Lanka. I believe outside media glare have to prevail upon Sri Lanka, because this kind of situation, this kind of ethnic fissure within Sri Lanka is not good for its own stability. Sometimes politicians, either in Tamil Nadu or in Sri Lanka, they are, you know, guided by their narrow political interests. But from national security's point of view, stability in Sri Lanka is very critical for us, and not only for us, even people of Sri Lanka. It's very important that, you know, no section of the community is discriminated. They are defeated. Sri Lanka has suffered this situation, and this has left deep scars, and those scars have to be healed. What is the best way to go about it? I feel that there has to be much closer engagement between India and Sri Lanka. Outside media glare, we have to prevail upon our Sri Lankan government, but this was a brilliant move that we have been voting at this multilateral platform. Yes, these platforms have a utility, but as Pastor also pointed it out, we have our own month. And as far as national security is concerned, I believe in that interest, we have to be tactical and firm both. So by abstaining from the same, we have maintained or rather kept our options open. I still think that we have to well confront on two issues, that is treating its minority very fairly. Secondly, our core interest, that under no circumstances, Sri Lankan territory could be used for presidential purposes by extra-regional powers or third countries, which has been happening. So I think from that perspective, this was a brilliant move, but behind the scene, our engagements have to continue.
Right. So I'll go to Ambassador. Ambassador, as you heard, we had to keep our interests in mind, national security interests. But there is an impression that now, we are not as vocal or maybe persisting on the rights issues of ethnic Tamils. Or maybe some people think that India has now given up or abandoned that cause. What do you say?
No, I don't think so. In fact, even in the English vote, which are represented in the Human Rights Council yesterday, it is very clearly stated that ask the Sri Lankan government to take care of the aspirations of the Tamil community in Sri Lanka. And therefore, we urge all steps should be including the holding the elections for the provincial council of Sri Lanka in keeping the, what is known as the 13th Amendment. The 13th Amendment of Sri Lanka, it created the provincial council, which lead the devolution property or powers.
And the but Ambassador, this 13th Amendment has been hanging fire for maybe over 2 decades. So India India has been pushing Sri Lanka, and Sri Lanka just ignores it. So on the ground.
In principle, I think we have been supporting that, and in also that India has a major step of creating housing for displaced Tamil in northern
Jaffna
and a very large program was undertaken, which is more or less, I think, completed in Sri Lanka. So we would, on one hand, support the rights of Tamils. On the other hand, we are of need for territorial integrity and of Sri Lanka, which is also important for India's security.
Right.
So it's a kind of balance which we have to strike. And both as Mr. pointed out, interference by regional powers for whatever their idea is not going to really help us.
Right.
Is not going to help Tamil in Sri Lanka. Yeah. Not going to help Tamil Sri Lanka either. So I think we'll have to take all these aspects into account, much as we are of the need to the human rights of Sri Lankans, including Tamils and Muslims in Sri Lanka.
Yeah. So it's not only about human rights. Mr. Oja, I'll come to you. Like, as you heard Ambassador saying that India has built houses and other things for the ethnic Tamils in Jaffna and Northern Peninsula. But the issue is not only about housing. The issue is about getting Tamils a right or participation in the democratic process or power. That is not happening. That has not been happening, which actually devolution and 13th Amendment talked about. What do you say?
I would say it is beyond that. First and foremost, requirement is, of course, stability and security over there. Yes, and for that, rights and aspirations of Tamils are very important. Right from SWRD Bandar Naike era, Sri Lankan politicians have been tempted to capture power by polarizing sentiment on ethnic lines, and there are a lot of issues I would like to get into detail, because northern area Tamils, because they had better access to education and most of employment opportunities, higher positions in state were captured by Tamils, and from there started this recent 5 years I have lived in Sri Lanka, Ajayji, and have engaged people across all divides. So what I feel that, yes, what you're saying is right, there are inbuilt constraints within the system, those have to be worked out. But it is better to work out these things outside public care, outside public testing, because the moment you start confronting Sri Lankan government or anyone and start humiliating them, the first principle of communication outside law is that you have to enjoy their trust. So our trust and goodwill with Sri Lankan government will decline. But having said that, Sri Lanka has to realize that India is a major power in this region, and India cannot be ignored. And that is why we have to build pressure.
And when we're building pressure, it should not be on ethnic lines at all. It should be on the lines of, you know, stability. Yes, politicians in Tamil Nadu, they have their political concerns, so they would like India to take a pretty strong position vis-a-vis Tamil. But, you know, when national security is involved, we cannot play this game of support Tamils or supporting places, because after all, Sinhalese people are also of Indian origin only. They are not from somewhere else. No, had it been China, they would have rather subsumed all these kind of people on same ethnic identity. But India has respected international borders. But having said that, I would say that we have to engage both Sinhalese as well as Tamil people, and at the same time bring sufficient pressure, institutional pressure, not only tactical concession, institutional pressure on Sri Lankan government to see that, you know, this kind of discomfort or this kind of sense of discrimination does not persist. As far as war crimes are concerned, these are reality. As far as discrimination is concerned, this is a reality. But sometimes I feel, you know, when you approach this multilateral platform through this third country entity, it turns out to be counterproductive. I would say that not only this, you see what they have done with ECT is this East Coast Terminal. So they have cancelled India, Japan, the same. So certain forces are trying to be receptive to that also. But as I said, appear friendly, appear the same, but always carry this sense of power that we are a powerful country. These are red lines. You cannot cross these red lines. That message has to be very clear. Unfortunately, this wasn't there 20 years back or 30 years back. So we hope that, you know, we continue with these two positions. We respect them. We give them a graceful listening. But at the same time, both red lines have to be respected by all concerned Sri Lanka.
Yeah.
That should be our
right. So, Ambassador, I'll come to you about red lines. So India has been marking these red lines for, I mean, over a decade or so right now. But when we mark these red lines, Sri Lanka plays China card. So how do you deal with that?
Well, they keep doing it. We keep pressurizing them. The regimes come and go. Regimes change in Sri Lanka. With each new regime, again, the policies also undergo change. I think we have made one point very clear to the Sri Lankans that India's security cannot be in any way endangered, any action from and be it China, be it any other power, we cannot accept any direction of that situation.
Right.
And whether it was matter or the terminal.
So, but Ambassador, despite that, Sri Lanka allowed China to operate that Hambantota port, and recently they have given some project to China, which is I heard that it's just 50 kilometers from Tamil Nadu coast. So again, it has impact on India's interest. Security.
It is happening. I agree.
Sri Lanka is playing its own games.
India first, as far as their security concerns are concerned, they have given that assurance. And we will have to constantly monitor the situation. And wherever we find that slipping, we have to bring it to their attention. I think both with respect to the human rights.
So what are the options? What are the options with India? Besides telling them or maybe giving no verbal?
Options on one hand, one is to intensify dialogue with Sri Lanka. And in that dialogue, our security concerns have to be put upfront without any hesitation. On the larger question of development assistance to Sri Lanka, India can still do it. India is a neighbor with which India has a traditional economic and commercial relationship with Sri Lanka, people to people exchanges with Sri Lanka. I think our economic and public diplomacy can do a lot with Sri Lanka. We are also members of such fora like the BIMSTEC, the Indian Ocean Rim Organization, and so on. So I think in all these, we have to work together, and the Sri Lankans also realize their interests best served by being close to India. So I think this is a multi-pronged approach that we have to follow with Sri Lanka.
Right.
And we need not get despaired or disappointed by the actions which Sri Lanka may be taking.
Yeah.
They are a sovereign country, do that, but not at our cost. I think that has to be made clear to the Sri Lanka.
Yeah, they are a sovereign country, Mr. Oja, I come to you. So, but while India has been so generous, we give vaccines, we help them in during tsunami, we do all, we go all out. But China plays its own games, inviting China, Sri Lanka plays its own games, I mean pitting China versus India. So, how do you see that development?
Look, they are sovereign countries, they have to be respected, but the kind of diplomacy and geopolitics we need in this region, there are no ready-made templates for that anywhere. I've been very vocal on that, Ajayji. There are issues in China, you know, rather in Sri Lanka, large number of politics. Even if something goes wrong, Sri Lankans look up to India. Not only Sri Lankans, but virtually all our smaller countries.
Yeah.
I wouldn't like to get into that detail, but there are multiple other ways of state power that has to be built. Look, you cannot abdicate your responsibilities, your security interests on goodwill and discretion of other people. I feel that, you know, when we are having these great power aspirations, we have to see that our institutions everywhere are of top class, and both internal governance institutions as well as diplomacy, these certainly certain capacities need to come over a longer period of time. But having said that, I think there are multiple levers of state power through which you can make them fall in line. It's not that, you know, they can carry on by insulting our national security interests or even bilateral agreements, etc. They should carry on doing that. Diplomacy is a very, very difficult and complex science, I would say, not an art alone. So I think there are multiple ways, you know, if our engagements are very strong within Sri Lanka, if our engagements are very strong outside, if we have other levers of state power, including a very efficient private sector, do you think this kind of situation would come up? And sometimes in this small thing, I don't think that if you are careful, then Sri Lanka can afford to antagonize it. A slight this thing had, you know, really brought the Sri Lankan government under pressure, and including the present prime minister, he has been bending backwards to accommodate India. I believe that, you know, we need our institutions to be of a really top class, both diplomacy and I have 2 degrees, by the way. One was research degree, was in diplomacy, and other was in defense and strategic this thing. So I think both have to go together. We cannot say that, okay, you are fine, you are sovereign, you can continue to harm my interests and I will look the other way. No, I'm not saying that. I said perfectly all right for India
so
to abstain from voting. At the same time, there has to be a cost. Moment you do something like this, moment you bring a third party, moment you bring an extra regional power, we cannot allow, you know, this kind of complicated bureaucracy to subvert our actions from within. So therefore, I think there has, our institutions have to be decisive and firm. Once it is very clear that, you know, they are trying to play this game, we have to tell them, look, you cannot play this game. What China has been doing, they have been trying to create small pockets of support, you know, as a part of this thing. They have no interest in stability and long-term security of Sri Lanka. They just want to grab a piece of their territory so that they can have a presence in Indian Ocean. They can have a kind of toehold to which they can rather
operate,
inflict some damage on India.
Yeah.
So if this kind of thing, Sri Lankan systems don't have integrity to appreciate something of this nature and prevent Sri Lanka from getting trapped into this, I think then India should be very well within its right to use all possible instruments of statecraft and diplomacy and geopolitics to tell them, to persuade them. I don't think this kind of situation would require. We have a brilliant man in Sri Lankan, as Sri Lankan foreign minister. He's a man of exceptional integrity. His father was also, you know, an exceptional person. He was, you know, he was in Pune and Bombay jail during freedom fighting this thing. So even present foreign minister, all said and done, he is a man of exceptional integrity. Buddhist clergy, most of them, they speak Hindi. They have had some connection with this, our part of this thing.
Yeah.
Instead of acting in a bureaucratic way, I think our diplomacy has to reach out to them, engage these people, harness these pockets of support, rather than only teaching coercion. Coercion comes at a later stage.
Right.
But Ajayji, sorry to say, we have been somehow diffident in engaging various sections of people in Sri Lanka and harnessing multiple pockets of goodwill that we have in that country.
Yeah, before we close, I want to ask, since you talked about we have been diffident, Ambassador Deore has handled Sri Lanka, so maybe he can answer that within a minute.
No, not only Sri Lanka, but in general, our approach has been like this.
Particularly, we are talking about Sri Lanka today, so maybe Ambassador Deore.
Well, I recall I was dealing with Sri Lanka Joint Secretary during the very difficult, critical period of 1983-85, when actually ethnic insurgency started in Sri Lanka.
Yeah.
And that was the time of very intense diplomacy that we engaged in. In fact, that was the time when the devolution of Sri Lanka was proposed.
So, Ambassador, we have to close. So, we have maybe 20 seconds. So, have we been diffident, or we have been, our policy has been on right track?
I think this latest decision to send a vaccine to Sri Lanka in large quantity was as a gesture of goodwill. Now, on commercial basis, I think it shows that, you know, we are going out.
Yeah, we have been going out.
Yeah. Including Sri Lanka. And on the security side, it is, we have never been different in the when a nuclear submarine was found in waters near Sri Lanka a few years ago. India took up this matter very firmly and very strongly.
Right.
So when it comes to our defense and security,
so we are
red line, absolutely.
So there are red lines. Yeah. So we had to close. Goodwill,
We will go full steam in providing support.
Right.
I will say one thing. I am not saying diffident at the level of political leadership or at the level of New Delhi. I would say Indian diplomats posted in Sri Lanka, they need to reach out to each and every pocket of support.
All sections, yeah.
Many times. It's not that it has not happened. It has happened. My ambassador was Mr. Nirupam Sen, very legendary person.
So,
even,
Mr. Ojha,
we have to close. Yes, I'm closing. If you have strong engagements within, whenever we had top class leaders, we had strong engagements within, our position was very strong. Somehow our institutions do not encourage something, and very often we don't reach out to people, and that is why we have a situation
So, Mr. Ojha, we hope that our institutions will reach out and maybe play a better role than they have been playing. But thank you both of you for participating in this debate today. This is all in the agenda today. Thanks for watching. I'll be back with another important topic tomorrow. Till then, goodbye.